Hello and welcome to Mastering Yoimiya 101. My name is Soron, and today we'll be walking through everything there is to know about team building around Yoimiya. Yoimiya is a pyro archer hailing from Inazuma. Unlike most archers who aim and fire powerful charge shots, Yoimiya rains down pyro-infused normal attacks. Her fast, far-reaching, auto-tracking attacks mean she's famously easy to play, and she has some of the best single-target damage in the game. Now, historically, Yoimiya has struggled due to her lack of AoE damage. However, with the addition of Denjo and Virgin, Yoimiya's trouble has been significantly mitigated. Coupled alongside great crowd control characters like Venti and Kaza, smart team building can more than make up for Yoimiya's individual weaknesses.
So what's that saying? What does crowd control mean?
Great question! Let's talk about team roles. So players throw around a lot of terms like main DPS, top DPS, support, battery, driver, and so on, but I'll put them all in context for you. A DPS is short for damage per second. This both refers to overall damage and to characters whose role is to deal damage. That means a main DPS is your main damage dealer, the one who's on field actively attacking. Yoimiya is typically in this role. A sub DPS is a secondary damage dealer who attacks from off field while on standby, so someone like Xingqiu, whose burst will give your on field characters follow up Hydro attacks. Then there's support characters, who, well, support. This can be buffing the team, keeping them alive, applying elements to enemies, and so on. A shielder shields, a healer heals, crowd control helps keep enemies together, buffers give various stat boosts, etc. Typically, support characters don't deal enough damage for us to note, but there are exceptions, like Anemo characters often do a fair amount of damage on top of crowd control, and reaction-heavy teams like Hyperplume can share on-field time a lot more than teams centralized around a main DPS. Okay, so now that you have a baseline, let's go back to Yoimiya. As we said, Yoimiya is most commonly used as a main DPS. More specifically, Yoimiya is a main DPS driver. Driver here refers to an on-field character who triggers the off-field effects of supporting party members. Drivers usually have fast attacks, consistent elemental application, or some utility that requires them to be on-field. Yoimiya is all of these, her utility being her metric fucktons of damage. If these roles and terms confuse you, don't worry. It's easy once you see an example. Let's look at the Vaporize starter kit team. Yoimiya, Xingqiu, Bennett, and a support character. In this comp, Yoimiya is our main DPS driver. She'll be doing her Yoimiya thing, pressing skill, then mashing attack. But before we get there, we have to inject some bulk her up a little bit. Our sub DPS is Xingqiu. As we said before, his burst gives us Hydro follow-up attacks from off-field and is a substantial source of our damage. Note that it's Hydro, meaning Yoimiya's attacks will now vaporize, effectively multiplying her damage. He also provides some damage reduction with his skill, which is always nice. Bennett plays a support role where his burst lets you play Circle Impact, a unique minigame much like the floor is lava. While you're in the circle, you get an enormous attack buff or very quick healing, and outside of it, you cry and die. Because Bennett is Pyro, he and Yoimiya together give the team Pyro Resonance, additionally buffing everyone's attack by 25%. And he's a great battery, or source of energy, though Yoimiya typically doesn't care about that. The shielder is there to make sure Yoimiya isn't interrupted while she's mowing enemies down. The golden standard is Daddy Zhongli, whose thick ass cheeks deflect any and all damage, but if you're like me and don't actually have him, we have plenty of alternatives. Diona can provide healing, Kirara applies Dendro for Virgin, Toma's a cutie, Leleshti, and so on. The result? You have a highly attack buffed, shielded, vaporizing Yoimiya. Simply put, there are very few singular enemies in Genshin who can survive this human machine gun. Usually they survive because they have invincible phases. Thanks, Boyo. This style of team, which we can just call Vaporize Yoimiya, is the standard for a reason. It's reliable and consistent. But the thing about team building for Yoimiya is that she's not really a hyper carry. A hyper carry is a character who, per their name, carries the entire team on their back. In Genshin, this is a singular DPS whom you devote all party buffs to. By contrast, Yoimiya as a driver is less powerful individually, but an incredible enabler of sub-DPS characters. She's kind of like a shonen protagonist, winning with the power of friendship. For this reason, I'll be diving into deep detail on characters other than Yoimiya to illustrate why they're good teammates for her. Don't assume that if a character isn't mentioned that they aren't good, I'm just pulling from my roster and my experience. Use these teams as reference to build an understanding of what Yoimiya needs to succeed, then mix and match with your own characters. Before we get into specific teams, though, let's address the elephant in the room, Yoimiya's lack of AoE damage. AoE stands for Area of Effect. While Yoimiya has monstrous single target damage per second, most enemies in Genshin come in groups. We can do some very basic math to see how Yoimiya's overall damage drops significantly as we account for more enemies. Compared to a character like Ganyu, whose arrows splash in an enormous AoE, Yoimiya can only hit one opponent at a time with hers. The more enemies there are, the worse this difference gets. Natively, Yoimiya has only one way of dealing AoE damage, her burst. which sucks. On activation, her burst selects an enemy and hits a small AoE around the target. If it hits, the target is marked, and any time a character other than Yoimiya hits the marked enemy, it'll trigger a small AoE explosion. This does count off-field attacks, so something like Xingqiu's burst will trigger this explosion even if Yoimiya is the one quote-unquote attacking. It sounds okay in theory, but the AoE is tiny, the damage is low, it only marks one enemy at a time, and it can only trigger once every 2 seconds. It does provide an attack bonus to her teammates, which is noteworthy, but not impressive. However, we now live in a post-Sumeru world, meaning we have Dendro. When Hydro and Dendro meet, they cause the bloom reaction, producing what's called a Dendro core. When you hit this Dendro core with Pyro, it causes Burgeon, exploding in an AoE of Dendro damage. Which brings us to our second team, Burgeon Yoimiya. As we talked about, Burgeon obviously requires Pyro, Hydro, and Dendro. 90% of our teams will have Xingqiu or Yelan, and this is no exception. Yelan is basically Xingqiu, but a MILF, which is why I use her. They have differences, but they're not really significant. For the purposes of this video, if you see one, you can use either. Your Dendro applicator, or the character applying the element, should ideally have the Deep Wood Memory set. This shreds Dendro resistance, meaning enemies will take more damage from Dendro, which includes Burgeon. The best Dendro character in the game, by far, is Nahida. Her skill lasts longer than her 500 years in timeout, and can easily hit every enemy on screen, simultaneously, every time, no energy required. Plus it deals absurd damage. Her burst buffs the active party member by 25% of her own EM, not only buffing Yoimiya's Burgeon damage, but also her vaporize damage. If that's not enough, Sisu Nahida even allows you to crit Burgeon. The Dendro Archon is overtuned as fuck. Burgeon Yoimiya with Nahida does have one weird issue, which is waves of weak enemies. Nahida has to mark her enemies with her skill to apply Dendro, there's no lingering effect for enemies who spawn in afterward. So, if everything dies instantaneously and you already hit Yoimiya's skill, switching to Nahida again means Yoimiya's skill ends, leaving you on cooldown. This isn't usually an issue, but in cases you do get waves of mobs, a character who leaves a lingering Dendro apply can be better. Luckily, everyone has access to Dendro Traveler, who's a fantastic applicator. At C6, Dendro Traveler's burst lasts a full rotation, can provide a small EM buff to your active character, and can buff your elemental damage if you hit the burst. Just build a lot of energy recharge to consistently burst. Kolei is an option if consistent Burgeon isn't as important, as she's a respectful sub-DPS even without reactions. At C2, her Dendro application gets a little bit better, as her skill gives her a lingering aura, and C4 makes her burst buff the party's EM by 60, which is a nice bonus. The last spot on the team is usually a shielder to keep Yoimiya safe from interruption. You can use a buffer, but the damage loss from dodging or getting hit usually outweighs the buffs. Just play a shielder with an artifact set that buffs the party. Zhongli is Zhongli. He's the shield guy, does sizable damage. I don't have him. I use Layla a lot in this slot. Her shields are top tier, and C1 buffs her shield strength even further. C4 buffs exactly one hit per rotation. Depending on the hit, this can be huge, but usually it's not important. What is important is Layla's shield consistently procs the tenacity of the middle of the set. If you have energy to spare, her burst can help semi-consistently freeze opponents, stunning them for a second and giving you the more damaging melt. A huge plus for Layla is that her shield is straightforward. It's just tapping her skill, it comes out at full strength, and it has the same duration as its cooldown, meaning she's easy to fit into rotations. Toma, while also a great option, is harder to use. On paper, Toma is a much better pick for Yoimiya than Layla. As a second pyro unit, you get pyro resonance, and at C6 he provides a 15% normal attack damage bonus with his shields. He's also a fantastic tenacity user. It's virtually always online. However, his shield works in a unique way. The skill version only lasts 8 seconds, but his burst gives pyro follow-up attacks and replenishes the shield every time a normal attack hits an enemy. This means his shields renew themselves, but only if you have the ER to fuel his burst. His follow-up attacks can also screw up your elemental auras sometimes. Diona is always worth considering thanks to her burst providing heals, and at C6, an enormous 200 elemental mastery buff. This EM, plus freeze into melt, will sizably increase Yoimiya's damage for a short time, especially with a Noblesse of Liege set. However, Diona's shields are notably weaker than the others, and she can't use the tenacity set effectively. Only the equipped character's skill can turn the buff on, and Diona's skill doesn't have a lingering off-field attack. If shield strength is important, use 2-piece tenacity, 2-piece forward Kasha. Those are the safe options. Now, if you're feeling spicy, at C4, Kirara can play a dual role of shielder and Dendro applicator, giving you a flex spot. Unfortunately, Kirara suffers the same issue as Diona and can't really use the tenacity set. C4 is important here. It gives you a follow-up attack while you have her shield up. It's only every 3.8 seconds, so she's not the best for Burgeon, but she's usable. Her C6 gives everyone a 12% all elemental damage bonus anytime you use her skill or burst, which is fantastic. Her burst is somewhat lingering, it leaves little Dendro bombs scattered around, which can help proc Burgeon. You can fill the flex spot according to your needs. An Anemo character for crowd control is fantastic for hordes of enemies. A nice synergy is that Anemo characters can suck in Kirara's scattered burst. Another Dendro character gives you Dendro Resonance and a more consistent Dendro Apply for Burgeon. Another Shielder can compensate for Kira's weak shields, letting you spec Kira into a sub-DPS if you want. A Buffer can improve Yoimiya's damage further. The possibilities are endless. Kira's a really cool character for this. But anyway, Burgeon Yoimiya solves her lack of AoE damage while still obliterating single-target enemies. It also has a wide range of elements to deal with any type of shield you come across. Overall, this is Yoimiya's best all-purpose team, handling just about everything decently. Prior to the release of Dendro, there was only one other way to give Yoimiya AoE damage: Overload. Overload occurs when Pyro meets Electro, causing a small Pyro damage explosion that can knock smaller enemies up or away. Overload Yoimiya has its uses, but in general, Burgeon and Vaporize are better compositions. Overload Yoimiya has some core issues. The first is Overload itself. Explosions can knock enemies out of attacks. The damage also scales poorly compared to Vaporize or Burgeon, and has a much lower damage ceiling. It requires significant investment in specific characters, namely Beidou and Fischl, to be usable, let alone competitive. And the strategy is practically unusable without C6 Fischl, and at least C2 Beidou, ideally C6. That said, Beidou is an extremely interesting character for Yoimiya. Beidou's burst deals follow-up electro attacks that bounce between enemies. It also provides damage reduction and resistance to interruption, with C1 additionally creating a shield. C2 hits more enemies per follow-up attack, and C6 shreds Electro, raising team damage. Fischl's skill summons Oz, who sticks around and periodically hits enemies with an Electro AoE. At C6, he gives Electro follow-up attacks, at which point Fischl becomes one of Yoimiya's strongest sub-DPSs. Fischl's burst resummons Oz, and since Fischl is an incredible battery, she typically has 100% uptime with Oz because of this. With Beidou and Fischl, you can turbo out Overload pretty consistently. Beidou's defensive properties leaves your last spot somewhat flexible, though usually you play support since you're still taking damage. Bennett compensates for Overload's low damage by buffing Yoimiya's individual damage and heals up what gets through Beidou's defenses. However, damage reduction and resistance interruption can't fully replace a shield. That's why I personally use Toma. Pyro Resonance and Tenacity will buff Yoimiya enough while keeping her utterly safe and hard. With enough ER, you can also consistently use Yoimiya's burst to provide a party attack buff, helping Beidou and Fischl's damage output. Because your rotations are consistent and your team's so defensive, Overload is an easy to pilot team, even by Yoimiya's standards. It's also sufficiently powerful. For instance, I was able to clear the so-called hardest Spiral Orbis of 3.7 using this team, as the Endless Overload proves quite good at compensating for Yoimiya's own lackluster shield breaking. Again though, this team does require a lot of investment. You burst with nearly everyone every rotation, except Yoimiya, so you have to balance a very high ER while still building Fischl and Beidou to do some damage. Overload Yoimiya has its uses, but they're more niche than Burgeon. Overvape Yoimiya is my personal favorite. This team takes advantage of the unique way that Electro and Hydro interact with one another. Unlike most reactions where auras are consumed when they meet, Electro and Hydro react as electro-charged, which keeps both auras active. This means when Pyro hits an electro-charged opponent, you trigger both Vaporize and Overload simultaneously, hence the name Overvape. We're running the Yoimiya Hydro shell as usual. As we discussed with Overload, both Beidou and Fischl make for great Electro sub-DPSs. Fischl has lower energy requirements and shorter cooldowns for easier rotations, while Beidou is stronger for groups of enemies and provides some extra bulk. Our last slot is usually a defensive support, just about any of the shielders work. But when you know you can get away without a shield, you can use a buffer like Bennett or Yunjin. We haven't really discussed Yunjin, and that's because she's not good for the Burgeon team, and I personally prefer more bulk on Overload. C6 Yunjin is a comparable or even better damage buffer for Yoimiya than Bennett, in exchange for not having heals. Yunjin's burst adds flat damage based on Yunjin's defense to Yoimiya's attacks before crit calculations. Essentially, Yunjin's attack buff is multiplied by crit damage too. Her C2 buffs normal attack damage by 15%, C4, which you'll pretty much always proc, buffs her damage increase further, and her C6 buffs normal attack speed by 12%, a very rare buff in Genshin. There are two big reasons Yunjin is superior to Bennett for Yoimiya. First, Yunjin's buff isn't an on-field AoE like Bennett, it's more like a status effect, so you have your full range of movement. Second, C6 Yunjin speeds up Yoimiya's attack string, which means more attacks per rotation, less opportunity for interruption, and reaching the end of her string more quickly, where most of her damage is. Funnily, because C6 Fischl doesn't specify once per second like most follow-up attacks, Oz also goes turbo. Yunjin does have very steep energy requirements, especially as a solo Geo, so pair her with Zhongli for an easier time. Overvape is great for boss killing, and with Beidou can be a good AoE team too. The stronger your sub-DPSs, the stronger this team is. Vape Melt Yoimiya has existed in theory for a while, but recently came to life thanks to Layla. This team combines the powerful crowd control effect of Freeze with Forward Melt. Forward Melt is what we call a strong reaction. When Pyro melts Cryo, the damage is doubled. Pyro is the strong element and Cryo the weak one. Compare this to when Cryo melts Pyro, which is a 1.5 times damage multiplier, a reverse melt. This holds true for Vaporize as well, only Hydro is the strong element there. Suffice to say, a Pyro character's melt does more damage than Vaporize. There aren't many Cryo applicators who apply quickly enough at the range Yoimiya needs to get melt consistently. We don't yet have a Cryo Xingqiu or Yelan. That's why we run Vape Melt. With our usual Vaporize pair, our enemies often have leftover Hydro auras. We can take advantage of this to freeze them, stunning them and giving us access to Melt. Even if we can't get Melt all the time, we're still getting Vaporize. With her burst and skill respectively, Layla fills both the Cryo Applicator and Shielder roles, leaving you a flex spot. A buffer is a reliable choice, so Bennett and Yunjin are both great. A second Cryo unit gives you more consistent freeze. Because of Yoimiya's range, we want huge AoEs, leaving us Rosaria and Ganyu. Rosaria's burst gives party members 15% of her own crit rate, so with a Noblesse Oblige set, she can help give your Yoimiya some absurd-looking stat lines. If you're using Ganyu as a sub-DPS, you're a whale or a freak. Which is why I tried it. Obviously, Ganyu is very powerful, but she requires a significant amount of ER to consistently burst. C2 helps her energy, and C4 increases all damage opponents take while in her burst. Her skill also taunts enemies, effectively reducing damage taken when used properly. If you want a boss-killing team, look no further. We've talked a lot about Xingqiu and Yelan, why not use both at once? Doubling up on Hydro gives us Hydro Resonance, buffing everyone's HP by 25%. This might sound unimpressive, but it makes Layla's shields that much stronger, and that's basically a 25% attack buff for Yelan. With both Yelan and Xingqiu giving follow-up attacks, Yoimiya cuts through enemies like they're butter. This team's also sufficiently good at crowd control, letting you tackle hordes of enemies as well. Vape Melt is probably Yoimiya's strongest team, but it obviously requires significant investment with very specific characters. If you can pull it off though, you can take on the world. This team is absolutely terrible, but I'll walk you through the logic. First, let's run the footage. And stop. Okay, let's talk about what's going on here. You know by now that we get Pyro Resonance. We're starting with Bennett's skill to apply Pyro. We rotate into Kazuha's burst, Swirling Pyro. C2 Kazuha gives your active character a 200 EM buff while in his burst, and with the Viridescent Venerer set, he shreds 30% of the enemy's resistance to that swirled element. You'll also hit the enemy enough times to proc his Freedom Sworn's buff, increasing normal attack damage by 15% and attack by 20%. Then we swap into Bennett's burst. With the Noblesse Oblige set and his own burst, we're gaining approximately 7 gajillion attack. Swap into Mona's burst. This will trigger her instructor set, raising the party's EM by a further 120. And her burst also increases damage against the marked target by 64% at talent level 9. Drop her skill so Yoimiya will get Vaporize. Finally, switch into Yoimiya and activate her skill, proccing her Shimon Owl Reminiscence set and turning on her Thundering Pulse passive. Keeping track? These are the bonuses you currently have. Yes, this team is flashy, and yes, when you pull it off, it's immensely satisfying, but holy moly is it bad. Damage showcases are never a good way to see how strong a character really is. They're gimmicky, and usually just one lucky attempt after dozens of bad ones. You don't need a team like this to maximize Yoimiya's damage, just use Melt, bro. Yoimiya might not have the biggest damage numbers, but she does a lot of damage, trust me. Congratulations on making it through Mastering Yoimiya 101. I hope that this video has been helpful to you in some way. This took a lot of effort and time, so if you want to see more content like this, please let me know down below and light up that like button. I genuinely do just love Yoimiya, so I hope that you'll use her and enjoy her as well. With the right team, she goes from decent to great, and I promise you that there's nothing she can't beat somehow. But I digress. Until next time, stay safe, stay healthy, and I'll catch you when I catch you. Class dismissed!